Good morning, Living Springs. The Lord be with you. This is the day that the Lord has made, so we will rejoice and be glad in it. I invite you to stand in body or in spirit as we worship our King this morning.
Come, now is the time.
Everyone needs compassion, a love that's never failing. Let mercy fall on me. Everyone needs forgiveness, the kindness of a Savior. As we approach your throne this morning, we know that you are a mighty God, all-powerful, omnipresent, omnipotent. And yet you are a Father, and yet you are a friend. And you loved us so much that you were willing to become like us. Humble yourself. Live among us, love us, and die on the cross for us. But thank God that's not the end of the story, because 3 days you rose again. Amen. So with boldness, we approach the throne with our sins, with our failures, with our insecurities, knowing that the arms of the Father are already wide, wide open for us. Ready to forgive. Ready to welcome us back. So we confess all the things that we have done and left undone. How we have hurt one another, been unfaithful to you. And church, I'm here to say, that God forgives you and God loves you and God is so, so, so good. Amen. Isn't God good? Amen. Let's sing of God's goodness together.
Of the goodness.
goodness of God. I will sing of the goodness of God.
Your goodness, Lord, does come after us. It runs after us, Lord Heavenly Father. We seek you day and we seek you night, Lord Heavenly Father. And we thank you, Lord, for your love and your mercy and your grace, none of which we deserve, Lord. But there you are every morning giving it to us in a fresh new way. So, Lord Heavenly Father, we come chasing you, Lord Heavenly Father. And we thank you, Lord Heavenly Father. We need you, Lord, like we've never needed you before, because it's a new day, a new dawning, Lord Heavenly Father. So, Lord, continue to run after us, Lord Heavenly Father. Run after us, grab a hold of us, shake us out, Lord Heavenly Father, and put us on the path that you and only you have for us, Lord Jesus. Lord, we thank you for this morning. We thank you for this service. I thank you for each and every person here today and those watching from home, Lord Heavenly Father. I thank you that you bring us together, not to be individuals, but to be a family. Lord, family, come together, Lord Heavenly Father, to worship you, to praise your name, to seek you and believe in you, Lord. We thank you. We thank you for what you do in our hearts each day, Lord. We thank you, Lord, for new beginnings and new opportunities, Lord. We thank you. Lord Heavenly Father, we bring before you the well trip, Lord, as they return from their weekend, Lord. We thank you, Lord, for what you did in the hearts of each and every member there. Each and every person that went seeking you, Lord, we thank you for the fire that they felt from you, Lord Heavenly Father. Fresh new beginnings for the youth today, Lord Heavenly Father. Let them come in these doors and give testimony of what you have done for them and through them, Lord Heavenly Father. We thank you for the leaders in this church, Lord, as they continue to grow us deeper and deeper, Lord Heavenly Father, leading us to you, Lord. Bless this service, Lord. Bless each and every person here today. And I thank you for it. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. Good morning, good morning, good morning. At this time, let us greet one another. And if there are any children here, let us send them to Sunday school. Okay, good morning, everyone. Good morning. Just a few announcements before we start service. We can take our seats. First, Ash Wednesday is coming up, as you know, on February 22nd. The sign says 7 p.m., but the reality is Ash Wednesday service will be a new experience. It's from 6 p.m. to 8 p.m., and it's a drop-in service. So what you do is you come in for ashes, you come in for prayer, you can stay as long as you like or as short as you like, but just come on in and receive what you need from the Holy Spirit as you walk through those doors, okay? Faith in Action, Riverdale Ministry is having a book drive for the Young Scholars of Washington and Park Elementary Schools. Please consider donating a variety of books, from level readers to chapter books. All donations are greatly appreciated. New or like new books, donations can be placed in the box outside the sanctuary, okay? Our mission of the month is we are highlighting Iglesia Brazos Abiertos, our sister church down in Honduras. Please continue praying for this community and church and consider funding the Great Commission. In your bulletin, there's a link for more information about the church, as well as a link to our giving page for the Great Commission. On Thursday, February 16th is Young at Heart from 9:30 to 11:30. It's for men and women, golden seniors, to come and spend time and do activities and just enjoy one another's company, fellowship, okay? Food, fellowship, and fun. So, and for those of you that attend Grief Share, just in case you missed last Sunday, we are now meeting in room 145. It's right outside the doors to the left, okay? At this time, I'd like to invite the ushers down for the offering. Lord Father, we thank you. We thank you for the many blessings that you pour over our lives, Lord, whether they be emotional blessings, spiritual blessings, financial blessings. Lord, we give back to you that which you have blessed us with, and we pray, Lord, that as it is offered with a genuine giving hearts, Lord. We pray that it is used to bless your kingdom in any way that you would like, Lord. Bless those who give and bless those who receive. And I thank you, Lord, for the ability to do so. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen.
There's no love, no angels, no powers, present things or things in the future. Heights, no depth, no any created thing could separate me from your love. There's no life, no angels, no powers, present things or things in the future. Height, no depth, no any created thing could separate me from your love.
Good morning, everyone. It is so good to see you all. Where have you been? I miss you folks. It is so good. It's such a joy to be with you. One of the things I get to do in my new position is I get to go to all kinds of different churches around, and that is fun, but I must say that there is no place like home. I was just thinking about that when I was worshiping with you, and it's so good to see my friends and my peeps, and I must say this. This is by far the best looking congregation I have ever served as a senior pastor and co-pastor. It's kind of like when I tell my daughter she's my favorite daughter, like, Dad, I'm your only daughter, but you're still my favorite. So how's that? It's great to be with you. Lots of folks have asked me, What do you do? And I tell my friends, I don't really know, because it's a whole kind of new movement. I get to be a part of starting a new kind of denominational network, we call it. And there's lots of behind the scenes things I do that no one would care about. But I kind of call myself a CSO, a chief serving officer. Really kind of what I get to do is I get to tell people about Jesus and tell people about what God is doing in this movement, and it's really fun to be able to do. And I get to kind of just envision what a new kind of movement looks like and just try to follow the Holy Spirit and try to keep up. And I'm also kind of the CSO, that I'm the chief stewardship officer. I get to steward the vision and values of this new movement that actually all of us are a part of. It's called the Kingdom Network. And so I might just take 2 minutes. Is that okay to talk about this? Is that all right? I'll show you what it is that the Kingdom Network is about. Try to figure out how to use my, I got to go to my message here, brah. There we go. How to we get to learn how to live the good life today. All right, we're going to talk about that. So here's the dream of this movement. It's a community of Reformed churches connected through a denom network. I think we made that term up, a denom network. It's denomination light. Like we have a 10-page book of church order as opposed to a 200-something page book of church order. It's simple. It's lean. But it's also a network. We kind of call it a network on steroids or a network with teeth, because we do have accountability. We have a shared covenant that we sign and agree to every year. We share financially with each other to do projects together and support one another. Even our Riverdale site is helped supported by through the Kingdom Network. So it is, we hold each other accountable. We love each other. We want to have a relationship with each other. So there's five words that when I tell people about the Kingdom Network, I highlight. We seek to be lean and nimble. That is bureaucratically and financially. We don't want to have a bunch of programs and a bunch of commissions and committees and all kinds of structure, but to be really lean and then also lean financially. We don't want to have all kinds of staff and programs and stuff that we have to pour lots of money into. We want the vast majority of our money going right into mission and raising disciples and planting new churches and works. And so we seek to be lean. We seek to be kingdom focused. Did you notice that Jesus didn't come building structures and organizations and all this? He came, what did he do? He came making disciples and ushering in the kingdom of heaven and healing and saving and delivering and setting people free. And so we want to really focus on the main things. And we seek to be relational. We don't want to fight with each other. We've been a part of a denomination that is very good at fighting. We don't want to fight with each other. We want to fight for each other and to help each other to become the very best that we can be and become. And we really think that doing life together should be a joy. And that we really should, this will be something that's brand new to you, we should really reflect the fruits of the Spirit. You guys know anything about the fruits of the Spirit? You've been in this series for a while, right? We should actually reflect the fruits of our Spirit. So it should be a joy to be together. And our mission is really simple, multiplying disciples, leaders, and churches together. So Kingdom Network is interdependent, just like a church. We're interdependent on each other, right? How many of you are the entire body of Christ rolled up into you? Now, we're many parts making up one body. And we think that as a movement of churches, we're better together, that we're interdependent. We need each other. So we're an interdependent movement of kingdom-minded Reformed churches. We're passionate about doing a couple things: planting churches, making disciples, raising up leaders, reaching and reflecting our diverse communities, and together we'll be better. So that's it. How's that in a nutshell? All right. And that's what we get to be a part of together, and it's fun. So right now you're a part of four regions: California, the crazy Californians out there, the Midwest, in the Plain States, Iowa, the Chicagoland area in Michigan. There are 24 churches, 34 sites, about 15,000 people kind of working together. And we're talking with about 20 other churches right now, and we get to be a part of this together. Amen? So enough about that, enough about me. I came to preach. And you know what Jesus would often say before he would preach or while he was preaching? He would say, to those who have ears to hear, let them hear. Now, you know what that means? It means lean in, listen up, dig in. Don't go to sleep right now. That the Sunday afternoon nap is for later. It's godly, Kate. You should have a Sunday afternoon nap, but not now. We get to dig in. So let's pray about that. Can we do that? Let's pray together. Jesus, we thank you for the privilege of listening and hearing your word today. And we open our hearts with expectation that you have something for every one of us today. So give us ears to hear what you would say to us, to me. I pray that you would even mess me up as I preach today with the goodness of your word, and that we would not just hear it, but be doers of your word. In Jesus' name. And everybody said? Amen. Amen. Are you ready? Yeah. Woo! All right. I get to continue our series on the fruits of the Spirit. We are talking, where's my, there, I got to, there, how to live the good life. So we're continuing our series on the fruit of the Spirit. And I would like to begin with a very life-changing story, because that's what I do. I tell life-changing stories that will change your life. My clicker's not working great. Here it is. Okay, we're there. Okay, so here's my life-changing story. There was a young man who just got his driver's license, and he was fired up to drive the family car. So he goes to his dad, who's also a pastor, and he said, "Dad, I'd really like to use the family car." And he said, "Son, I think that would be great. There's just a couple things first. I noticed your grades. I need you to get your grades up. And I'd love to see you study in your word. And, bro, you need a haircut. So do those things, and then we can have a conversation." So a couple months later, the young man comes to dad again, Pastor Dad, and he says to dad, he says, "I'd really love to have that conversation about the car, Dad." And the dad says, "Son, I am really proud of you. I have seen your grades coming up. I have seen you digging into your word. But, dude, your hair is bad. It is really long." And then he says to dad, "Well, Dad, I was wanting to kind of talk to you about that. Because, you know, I noticed in Scripture as I'm reading it, you know, Samson had long hair. Moses had long hair. Jesus and his disciples probably had long hair." And his dad said, "You know what? You're right. And they walked everywhere they went." That has very little to do with what my message is today. But today, I do want to give you the keys to the good life. I'm going to give you the keys to the good life today. Actually, the scriptures are going to give you the keys to the good life. So, when you think about the good life, what immediately comes to mind? Paradise. That's going big. What else? You think about the good life. What do you commonly think of? Peace of mind. What else? Being rich. No bills. Anybody got an amen? Do you think about nice vacations and beautiful places and fat paychecks and wallets and bank accounts? Do you think about those things? And those things are good. They're nice. But we all know stories of folks who have it all. They have all of the experiences. They got all the money in the world. And they are desperately unhappy. Many have committed suicide, are broken and hurting, have devastating relationships and marriages and so on and down the list. Having the outward stuff isn't necessarily having the good life, okay? So what is the good life? I wonder if I got ahead of myself. I haven't preached in a while. I forgot how to do this. Can somebody help me? I forgot how to preach. The Bible has a word for the good life, and it's a delicious word. It is shalom. Say shalom. Isn't that delicious? It means well-being. It means peace. It means a sense of harmony with God and with people. It is an inner sense that life is good no matter what the external circumstances. It goes beyond the stuff. It's this internal thing that all is well. It's shalom. And that is the biblical word that goes beyond often our cultural understanding of the good life. And really, the scripture, the fruits of the Spirit are really speaking about the good life. The Apostle Paul writes in Galatians about the fruits of the Spirit, but it's part of a larger teaching on freedom, life. And it's really speaking about what is the good life. And in this passage, if we've been studying this, in the larger passage, it gives us two visions of life. There's the old life, which Paul calls the flesh. Do you remember this? It's the flesh. And it really is talking about BC, before Christ. What is life like before Christ? And then he shows and he talks about what does the flesh look like? What's the fruit of the flesh? And then he talks about the fruits of the Spirit. This is the new life, life in the Spirit, which he suggests is the actual good life. So he begins with the fruits of the flesh, the old self. And he says the acts of the flesh are obvious. Sexual immorality, impurity, debauchery, idolatry and witchcraft, hatred, discord, jealousy, fits of rage, selfish ambitions, dissensions, factions, envy, drunkenness, orgies, and the like. I warn you, as I did before, that those who live like this will not inherit the kingdom of God. Whoa, that's some heavy stuff, isn't it? Kind of sounds like a Netflix show, doesn't it, a little bit? I want to ask us, is this the good life? Now, this is what's often glorified in, you know, media and so, but is it really the good life? And I don't want us to see it as, don't do these things, but rather as a loving father that says, you know, the wages of sin is death. You know, if you carry out any of these things to their logical extreme, they lead to death, physically, spiritually, emotionally, relationally. It's brokenness. It's a mess. But he goes on and he talks about, gives us a vision of the good life. Read it with me. Ready? But the fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control. Stop there. I was reading one commentary, and it was he talked about the fact that there's kind of three types of fruits of the Spirit: upward, outward, and inward. So first of all, the first three are kind of upward. They show the character, the basic character of God. There's love. The word for that is agape. It means the radical, unconditional, no matter what love of God for his kids. Do you know when he sees us, what he thinks is, I love these people. It's love. And when we love God and love people, it leads to this thing called joy. This isn't based on circumstances. It's this internal sense of being. It's just having joy. And when you're loving and when you have joy, it leads to this thing called peace. The Old Testament word for this is shalom. It is this sense of contentment no matter what. The Apostle Paul gets beaten 5 times to the point of death. He gets stoned. I'm not talking about with the funny stuff. He gets stoned by real stones, left for dead. He's sitting rotting in jail, and you know what he says? I have learned the secret of contentment, that no matter whether I'm rich or poor, having little or much, I have learned the secret of being content in any and everything. And he says, I've learned the secret of being content. It's in Christ. Okay? So there's this contentment. So there's these upward fruits, then there's these outward fruits. When we have these upward fruits, love and joy and peace, it leads to outward, how we treat one another. How we, you know, there is, the old word for it is patience or forbearance, kindness, goodness. We're going to talk about today. So that's how we are towards people. And then it reflects our inner character. We're faithful. We are gentle. And gentle is a powerful word. It is the security to be humble and to be gracious towards others. It is self-control. And he says, against such things there is no law. This is the good life. There is another kind of life. It's life in the Spirit of God. And today, I get to teach about goodness. So today we're on goodness. Now I'm just going to keep it real. I'm being honest here. I'm sorry in advance for what I'm going to say. When I found out which fruit I got, I was not immediately excited. In fact, I was kind of like, isn't that kind of the boring fruit of the Spirit, goodness? I'm just keeping it real. I'm thinking, love, joy, those are the cool ones. But I got goodness. And, I think about the songs that we love. Michael Jackson sings, I'm bad, you know it. I don't know if Michael Jackson was bad or not, but he sang about bad. Any of you old people remember George Thorogood? Any old people? I'm bad to the bone. Any of you remember that? Bad. Even Billie Eilish is singing about bad. I'm the bad guy. She's very depressed. But she's a bad guy. Nobody's singing, I'm good to the bone. That seems kind of boring, doesn't it? I mean, it's like when my mom goes away and she'd say, now, Dave, I'm going shopping. Now, you be. It's kind of the absence of being. It's not doing bad things. And I think sometimes we have kind of a negative, or because we have this kind of impoverished, and when I say that, I'm including me, an impoverished understanding of what goodness is. And I include myself there. And I have to admit that as I dove into this deeper and studied, I was kind of blown away by the grandeur and power of this little word, goodness. It's a powerhouse. Get ready, gang. Strap on your seatbelts. Let's go. So we get to think about goodness today, and it's not just doing bad things. So what is goodness? Goodness, I'm going to come back to the rest of this passage. Goodness is agathosune. That's the Greek word, agathosune. Agathosune. I can say it. Agathosune. Agathosune. Say it with me. Agathosune. And yes, it means moral excellence. That's one of the definitions. But the primary is, and by the way, there's no one English word that really captures well this word agathosune. It means active benevolence. It means a disposition to do all the good we can. It means selflessly acting on behalf of others. Now, who does this sound like? Yes, thank you, Sunday school goers. It is Jesus, right? I mean, think about Jesus' life. Think about what Jesus did. Jesus went around preaching and teaching the good news that liberated people from the law of oppression. He talked about the good life, and then he demonstrated the kingdom of heaven by healing people and saving and delivering and setting people free from the powers of demons and darkness. He spoke life. He loved and valued every person, no matter how high or low they were. He just loved people, and people wanted to be around Jesus. And you know what he got? You know what the reward for his amazing life was? He got to hang on the cross and bloodied and bleeding and dying. You know what Jesus does? He takes care of his mom. Then he takes care of the person next to him, and he shows them the way to eternal life. He forgives the ones who just brutalized his body. And then he said, it's finished. I've done everything that the Father has told me to do. Jesus is the picture of goodness. And if I were to give goodness just a little, a kind of short summary, it's these words: goodness is love in action. Don't want you to forget that one. Are you ready? What is goodness? It is love in action. Goodness embodies all of the other fruits lived out. It is goodness. So we're going to dive in a little deeper. The million-dollar question is this, is how can we become more like Jesus? How can we live lives that reflect this fruit of the Spirit? How do we do it? Well, here's the deal. You can't do it. Give up now. It is impossible. Let's pray. Now, I'm not saying it can't be done, but I am saying you can't do it on your own. You cannot do it on your own. A while back, I was talking with a woman who was very distraught and upset and angry with herself. She said, I just can't do it. I have tried everything and I can't stop. She had deep anger issues. And every time someone would cross her, she would go off on them and just say whatever comes to mind. And it left a string of broken relationships, broken marriage, broken relationship with her kids and friends, and over and over and again. And she just says, I'm just so frustrated. And I asked her, I said, do you think that you can change? Do you think people change? And she said, well, I don't know. I have tried everything, and I can't seem to do it. This is the way I was raised. This is what I have seen. This is just the way it's just the way I am. Kind of like Popeye the Sailor Man. I am what I am. This is just how God made me, she even said. And then she looked at me, and she said, do you think people change? Do you think they can? And I said, no, I don't think so. I don't think so. And she goes, really? And I go, no, I'm kidding. Of course people can change. I wouldn't do what I did or do if I didn't think that people could actually change. This is the heart of the good news of the gospel, that we can actually be transformed to become more and more like Jesus, that we can shed an old life and to become brand new, that we can be remade, that we can actually reflect the glory of King Jesus. Yes, I wasn't quite as passionate as I am right now, but I absolutely believe people can change. This is the story of Scripture. God takes this entitled, rich, snot-nosed kid who was raised by Pharaoh, and he kills a guy thinking that he's above the law, and God has to take him into a desert for 40 years and transform him from the inside out, and he goes back, and he's the greatest leader that the world has ever seen. I think of this guy named Peter, who's this hard-headed fisherman who's always sticking his foot in his mouth and denies Jesus 3 times, and he becomes one of the most sweet-spirited, godly leaders that the world has ever known. I think of so many people. I think of this guy who hated Christians, persecuted the church, had people killed for following Jesus, and becomes the greatest missionary of all times. Who is that? Apostle Paul. And I said, it's not just then. I said, it's right now. I said, I think of this young man when I was a youth pastor, and his dad committed suicide. His mom was a raging alcoholic. He lived in abject poverty, raising his sister. He was a mess. She was a mess. The house was a mess. It was a disaster. And this kid met Jesus. And today, he is one of the most godly fathers and husbands who loves his kids and loves Jesus. Can God change lives? You better believe it. I think of this man that I know now. He used to be an MMA fighter. If you crossed him, he would mess you up. He got paid to hurt people. And now he's one of the best evangelists that I know. And he loves the snot out of people. They have no snot today. Does Jesus change lives? You better believe it. But again, how does this work? How does God change lives? Well, I want us to think about this. Now, before I go there, I just want to get up in your grill for a second. I want to ask you, are you changing? Are you becoming more like Jesus? Are you more like Jesus today than you were a year ago? 10 years ago? Are you becoming more and more like Jesus or more and more like the world around us? How is it that we change? How do we cultivate the fruits of the spirits and uniquely this fruit? I want to share a couple of scriptures. First of all, in the Old Testament time, there was an understanding that only God was good. Look at what Jesus says in Mark 10. These are interesting words if you don't have that backdrop. Verse 17, Jesus started on his way, a man ran up to him, fell on his knees before him. "Good teacher," he asked, "what must I do to inherit eternal life?" "Why do you call me good?" Jesus answered. "No one is good except God alone." See, what he's doing is he's just reminding them of what the basic teaching was at the time, that only God was good. And yet, Paul, a little while later, says that we can have the fruits of the Spirit, have a whole new life. What happened between Jesus and Paul's teaching here about the fruits of the Spirit? What happened? Jesus died, and he rose again, and he sent the Holy Spirit. These are the fruits of the Holy Spirit. These fruits are imparted to us from Jesus by the Holy Spirit to us. Take a look at this next passage. Jesus said these words, "I am the vine, you are the branches. If you remain in me and I in you, you will bear much," what? "Fruit. Apart from me, you can do squat. You can't do nothing." How's that for English? But if you remain, so what's the Holy Spirit's job? Producing fruit. What's our job? Staying connected to Jesus, right? So, fruit is something that is imparted to us from Jesus through the vine to us, the branches. And now I want you to hear what I'm saying and what I'm not saying. I'm not saying that we do nothing, that this just magically happens or something. We do have an active role to play. Now, I am not a gardener. I am not a gardener. I do not garden. I eat garden products. My wife is a gardener. I am not a gardener. I mow things, she grows things, okay? That's how it works. And I want to share how this happens, how this works. I know lots of things about gardening. So what happens is in the springtime, she opens the back door and she throws a bunch of seeds out there, and then all of a sudden there's this beautiful garden that emerges. Yeah. Right? That's how that works. Is that how that works? Okay. So what happens is that she gets seeds and she plants them, and she has to take care of the soil and make sure the soil is good, and even put some magic things in there that helps the soil grow things better, and then has to water and weed and do all those things to the garden so that it bears good fruit. Now, could she make fruit? Well, not really. You know, I love, there's a poet that says, "We our brow sweats and we work hard and leave it to grace." Because ultimately, only God can make it grow. It's this magic of life, you know, this glory of life. So, but absolutely, we are a part of it. And in the same way, the fruits of the Spirit are fruits of the Spirit of God. So they come from God, but we have an active role to play. What does that mean? Galatians 5, what comes right after the fruit of the Spirit. Those who belong to Christ just play and mess around with the flesh, right? Have what? What does crucify mean? Put to death the flesh with its passions and desires. This is like doing the weeding, getting the weeds out so that the seeds can grow. Because if our lives are just filled with the fruit of the flesh, it's going to choke out the work of the Spirit of God in us. So we got to pull out the fruit. Now, what we actually have to do, this is going to sound crazy, we actually have to put to death the sins of the flesh. This is not what our culture teaches. I'm just keeping it real. Our culture says, you do you. Okay? That's what it says. This is how God made me, I guess. In every area, we can just go with the flesh, yep, but it leads to death. And so if we want to bear the fruits of the Spirit, we need to put to death the passions and desires of the flesh, and then, which only kill anyway, by the way, and then we need to live by the Spirit. Let us keep in step with the Spirit. What does it mean to keep in step with the Spirit? What does that mean? Keep in step with the Spirit. Well, I'm going to suggest that it means Him in His work. It's keeping in step with the Spirit, not falling behind, not missing out, but seeing what the Holy Spirit is doing and joining the Holy Spirit. If I was to kind of summarize what our role is in bearing the fruit of goodness, it would be this. We surrender to Jesus, we stay close to Him, and sacrificially join God in His work. Okay? That's our gardening work. We surrender to Jesus. I pray this prayer every morning. Now, I'm going to probably embarrass myself and not forget it, but what is the prayer I pray every morning is, Father, help me to live this day to the full, being true to you in every way. Jesus, help me to give my life away to others, being kind to everyone I meet. Spirit, help me to love the lost, showing Christ in all I do and say. And that's just this kind of prayer of surrender, just saying, okay, Jesus, use me today. Let's surrender to Jesus, and we need to stay close to Him. And that means that what you do is you pray in the morning, and then you forget about Jesus the rest of the day. Right? That's how that works? That's how we keep in step with the Spirit? Sometimes that's how we can live our lives. We maybe have a prayer in the morning or at night, and then live the rest of our day as if we're atheists. It means actually learning to walk with Jesus throughout our day. When things are happening throughout our day, we're praying through it. We're asking Jesus to help. And somebody once said that prayer is to the spiritual life like wings are to a bird in flight. This isn't oppressive. This gives our lives wings. And then we join Jesus in His work. And Jesus is so practical, gang. He gives us this amazing story in Luke that illustrates what goodness is all about. And remember, what is goodness? Anybody remember way back when? Goodness is what? Love and action, right? Any wild guesses which parable I want to highlight today that's going to really practically teach us about what does it actually mean day to day to live the good life? Anybody? Isn't that crazy? The Good Samaritan. We're going to look at the Good Samaritan. So, a picture of goodness. This is really a picture that Jesus gives of goodness. Now, let me give a little of the background, and we're going to dive into the story, and we're going to end with this, okay? So, Jesus is minding His own business, and this religious leader comes up to Him and says, good teacher, what must I do to inherit eternal life? And Jesus does what Jesus often does. He kicks it back to dude, and He says, well, what do you think? And dude says, love the Lord your God with all your heart, mind, soul, and strength, and love your neighbor as yourself. And Jesus says, ding, 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 do it and you'll find life. And then the man says, well, who is my neighbor? And the words of Scripture says he asked this question to justify himself. Now, what does it mean to justify ourselves? He wanted to feel good about himself. He wanted to keep the bar nice and low. He wanted to get the easiest way out. And honestly, I'm not making this up, the popular teaching at the time, this was not scripture, but this was the teaching at the time from the rabbis was, is if there was a person who was a sinner, you didn't need to help them because they were getting what they deserve. Right? They're getting what they deserve. Good. And the other teaching was that you were to help your fellow Jew. If someone looks like you, smells like you, acts like you, votes like you, then you should be good to them. That's what they literally taught. Do good to a Jew. Kind of sounds like us today, right? We're going to love those in my tribe. But if you're in that tribe who is the enemy, I can do whatever the heck I want. Because that's what Jesus taught. Not so much. Well, Jesus said, we might have to do a little work here. And so he tells this parable. There is a man walking, a Jew walking from Jerusalem to Judea. And he is, there are thieves in the area. And he was robbed, beaten, stripped naked, left for dead. So you can imagine how this man is feeling. He's barely alive. But then, through his almost shut eyes from being pounded on, he sees someone coming, a priest and a Levite that's a pastor and a worship leader. And he thinks, I'm saved, right? That's a nope sandwich right there. Nope Stradamus. They walk as far from this man as they can and walk around. But then something crazy happens. This Samaritan. Now, this story, Good Samaritan, would be an oxymoron to a Jew because everybody knows, if you're a Jew, that there is no such thing as a Good Samaritan. They were the enemy. They were the bad guys. Maybe like today, if it was a Ukrainian and a Russian, you're laying there dead, and then you see a Russian, you think, now I'm really done. And so dude is probably thinking, it's over for me. But what does the Samaritan do? Let's stand. Let's honor the word, can we? Take a look at this. I love this. I want you to see what this Samaritan, remember, he's the enemy, does. But a Samaritan, as he traveled, came where the man was, and when he saw him, he had what? Compassion on him. And he went to him, bandaged his wounds, pouring on oil and wine. He put the man on his own donkey, brought him to an inn, took care of him. The next day he took out 2 denarii and gave them to the innkeeper. Look after him, he said. And when I return, I'm going to reimburse you for any extra expenses you may have. Wow. This is the bad guy. But he's the good guy. All right, you can be seated. I want us to think about this a little deeper. What do we learn about goodness from this? I'm going to give you 3 words, and we're going to pray together. What do we learn about goodness from Jesus' story here? Well, the first thing is goodness involves compassion. It involves actually seeing and stopping. Look at these words again. But a Samaritan, as he traveled, came where the man was, and when he saw him, he had compassion on him. And I forgot to include this, but the next words are, he went to him. Now, rather than the good pastor and worship leader, he didn't walk around, he walked right to the man. What is compassion? Compassion is different than pity. Pity would say, oh, poor guy. Or even worse in our culture today is, yeah, he's getting what he deserves. But pity would say, oh, poor guy. Somebody should really do something about that. But compassion is different. Compassion sees, it stops what we're doing, and actually does something. Because goodness is? 7 of you got that. Goodness is what? It's love in action. It actually does something. And so he does something, and he helps the man. Now, Jesus' example is a pretty dramatic one here, right? I mean, this is for real. I'm going to talk about that in the next point, but what he does. But what might this look like for us in our day-to-day lives? What might that be? Might it mean just walking through our day with our eyes open? Maybe it's seeing a coworker or someone at school or someone in our neighborhood who just doesn't look right, maybe upset or so. What would it look like for us to say, hey, are you okay? Is there anything I can do? And then doing this very powerful thing. It would be all right if I pray for you. Maybe it's seeing a child that has some areas of need, and we actually take the time to help. What if we're in a room that's crowded, but there's one person who's off in the side? Nobody's paying any attention to that one. What would it be like for us to go over and say, hey, what's up? I have a good friend. Every time he goes out for dinner or lunch at a restaurant, he talks with the server. And then he says, hey, when the food comes, we always stop and pray. Is there anything that I can pray for you about? And he said, you know how many times he's been turned down for that request? One. And the guy says, yeah, I'm not really into that kind of thing. And he goes, that's fine. But just to care about people enough to see them, to stop, and to actually do something. Goodness involves compassion. Second thing we learn from this story is that goodness involves risk. It might get messy, folks. He went to him, bandaged his wounds. This means you're getting blood and gunk on yourself. And he pours on oil and wine. Then he puts dude on his own donkey. Now, I was kind of imagining what this would be like. For me, if I see a guy who's beaten, bloodied, naked on the side of the road, and I pick him up and put him in my nice car, it might mean getting messy. And then he brings him to an inn and takes physical care of dude that he doesn't even know, that people like him didn't even like. This is what goodness does. It might take a risk. I love the words of Martin Luther King Jr. when he was preaching on this passage. He said, the priest and the Levite asked the question, what might happen to me if I stop? But the Samaritan asked the very opposite. He said, what might happen to this man if I don't stop? Love risks. It steps outside of what is comfortable, and it might even mean getting messy. Third thing that we learn, goodness involves generosity, time, and money. So he uses six verbs here, Jesus does, to describe what the Good Samaritan does. Look at what he says. He went to him, bandaged his wounds, poured on oil and wine. Then he put the man on his own donkey and brought him to an inn and took care of him. The next day, he took out 2 denarii and gave them to the innkeeper. Look after him, he said. And when I return, I will reimburse you for any extra expense you may have. I mean, can you say over and above? I mean, this man actually, this costs him something, doesn't it? It's pretty extraordinary what this man does. Now, he gave 2 denarii. Now, a denarii was the wages for a day of a laborer. Okay? That was a day's wages, and he gave 2. So let's say you make $50,000 a year. That was giving this man that you don't know and your people would not like $400. And if you make $100,000 a year, that would be $800 that you give to this man that you don't know and might not like. Goodness actually gives. Margaret Thatcher said about this, if the Samaritan only had good intentions, we would not remember this story. But he had good actions. He gave from the most sensitive part of his anatomy, his wallet. I'm messing now, aren't I? But when we see, does it actually impact us? When we see, does it move us to action? Now, yeah, absolutely give money. You know, I think when we see things like we see that's happening in Turkey, I mean, think about Syria. Thank you. I was brain freeze. Syria, I'm talking about Samaria. Syria, you know, just going through all of the extraordinary things of a civil war and then this catastrophe. And I was doing a devotion this week that was just having us picture what this whole thing was like. And all of a sudden, my heart broke. And then I'm thinking, how can I not do something? I better do something. And sometimes it will cost us something from our wallet. But compassion is really more than just giving. It's actually being willing to risk. It's being willing to stop and to really see people. I want to ask us this morning, are you good? Now, I'm just going to be honest here. As I dealt with this passage, you know, I think of myself as a good guy. I'm a good guy. Better than the next guy. But am I really good biblically? And what the fullness of what that word means. Do I stop? The truth is that so often I am so stinking busy and so caught up in my own stuff that I don't really see people. I just walk by. And when I read this passage again, I was like, I'm that priest. And when I think about the fact that compassion is willing to risk, I've done some risks. But the majority of my life is spent very cautiously leading the most comfortable life I can live. Am I willing to risk? And am I generous? Sometimes I'm generous. I learned from someone else. I keep $20 in my wallet. I just keep it there, and it's not for me. It's for whatever need. And so if I see somebody and the Holy Spirit prompts me, I just give it. And if I'm at a restaurant and they need an extra tip, I give it. And it's this little joy that I have. Is that really sacrifice? I don't know. It's nice, I guess. And so, you know, are we really willing to give of ourselves? I want to ask us to stand and let's take a moment to pray about this together, gang. Goodness is love in action. And Kate, you can come up and play if you want to play something. Let's pray about this. I want us just to take a moment to reflect on our own lives. And I want to ask, how are you really? Are we displaying the fruits of the Spirit? Not that we can do it on our own, we just absolutely can't. Are we connected to Jesus in a real and meaningful way? And maybe when we reflect on our lives, we recognize that we're pretty much self-absorbed. And today, we might need to take a moment to repent. And that just simply means to turn, to say, God, I don't want to just live in the fruit of the flesh, but I want to live in the fruit of your Spirit of goodness. So I turn to you and I give myself to you. Let's go ahead and take a moment in quiet prayer to pray. And whatever's inside, let it give that to Jesus, whatever you might need to say in repentance. Forgive us, Jesus, for where we are often so caught up in our own thing that we miss you. And Lord Jesus, we're going to pray together that prayer. Lord Jesus, use me. I'm available. I surrender to you. Lord, might I walk with your Spirit and be available to be used in whatever way that makes sense. Whatever way you lead, I will follow. Lord, help me to be open to risk and to sacrifice, to generosity. Lord Jesus, I will be careful to follow you. In Jesus' name. In Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. I want to invite the prayer ministers to come on up. And during this closing song or time, if any of you need prayer for anything, we want to pray for you. So any prayer ministers, come on up. We always want to pray for folks. If there's something that you want to confess today, or if there's some way you want to pray today, or that you could use prayer for, we'd love to pray for you. So I want to give you a blessing and an encouragement today as we go. Let's pray this prayer that I pray. Pray it together. If this is your heart, pray it with me in silence. Heavenly Father, help me to live this day to the full. Lord Jesus, help me to give my life away to others, being kind to everyone I meet. Spirit, help me to love the lost, proclaiming Christ in all I do and say. And now may the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious to you. May the Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you his peace and the fullness of the Holy Spirit, that you may bless others even as you have been blessed, that we might live truly good lives. Amen and amen.
It's running after me. Your goodness is running after. It's running after me. With my life laid down, I'm surrendered now. I give you everything. Your goodness is running after. It's running. All my life. goodness of God. Yes, I will sing of the goodness of God.